Bueno, buenas noches con todos ustedes. El Lifetime Achievement Award es un reconocimiento que hacen los Harvard Clubs en distintos países a aquellos exalumnos que han contribuido a lo largo de su vida al desarrollo de su país y de su comunidad. A través de sus carreras, estos distinguidos graduados, además de aportar sus conocimientos, han mantenido los más altos estándares y valores en todos sus emprendimientos, siguiendo el ejemplo que la Universidad de Harvard exhibe desde su fundación. Son modelos a seguir e inspiran a todos aquellos que aspiran a tener un impacto en su entorno profesional y en su país. En el Perú, a raíz de la constitución formal del Harvard Club en el año 2010, siendo el señor Manuel Montori presidente, se inició esta premiación. Y en el año 2011 se le entregó este reconocimiento a don Alberto Benavides de la Quintana, reconocido empresario minero. Luego, en el 2015, durante la presidencia de Víctor Marroquín, se entregó el premio a doña Beatriz Merino, Cero, en reconocimiento a su contribución al país como primer ministro y defensora del pueblo. Luego, en el 2016, durante igualmente la presidencia de Víctor Marroquín, se entregó este premio al arquitecto Edward Barclay, que está hoy día acá acompañándonos, ¿no?, y que agradecemos también su presencia, por su participación como arquitecto y desarrollador urbano. La presente directiva del club, que me honro en presidir, tomó la decisión de entregar el Lifetime Achievement Award al doctor Richard Webb Duarte ya desde el año pasado. Sin embargo, la pandemia y las restricciones sanitarias han impedido realizar la ceremonia, sino hasta hoy que finalmente podemos concretar este evento. Entonces, es parte de las últimas actividades de esta directiva, pues estamos próximos a convocar a nuevas elecciones para renovar la directiva. Estamos muy agradecidos a la Universidad San Martín de Porres, a su rector y al ingeniero Becerra por habernos brindado no solo las instalaciones físicas, sino todas las facilidades técnicas para celebrar este merecido reconocimiento al doctor Webb, quien es, como sabemos, director también del Instituto del Perú, el Centro de Investigación en Ciencias Sociales de esta universidad. El programa que desarrollaremos hoy va a ser breve debido a las restricciones sanitarias que aún enfrentamos, y también debido a ello contaremos con dos expositores que compartirán desde distintos ángulos su experiencia profesional con el doctor Webb y participarán de manera remota, vía Zoom. Serán el doctor Ricardo Lago, economista y consultor, quien reside en Miami, y el doctor Julio Velarde, presidente del Banco Central de Reserva del Perú. De manera presencial participará el ingeniero Carlos Loret de Mora. Gracias nuevamente por su presencia y esperamos que podamos iniciar ya toda la secuencia de presentaciones. Gracias.
Buenas tardes. Me han pedido que haga mi presentación en inglés en deferencia al embajador de Japón, que no cuenta con traductor. I admire Richard Webb. His talent for observation and reflection on the economic and social trends is unparalleled. He knows how to capture the essence. And he does not bother to express inconvenient opinions. Our common friend Roberto Abusada, who sadly recently left us, once told me, "In Peru we have many economies, but we need more thinkers like Richard." And indeed, Richard is an eclectic. Neither capitalism nor socialism, quite the opposite. He is a free thinker, does not espouse any school of thought. If the facts disprove his ideas, he yields to the facts. He travels to the small towns, talks to the people, gathers anecdotes, takes measures, compares with his previous trip, analyzes the facts, and draws policy conclusions that few economists are able to. He is willing to travel very far to find the facts. And as T.S. Eliot once said, only those who risk going too far can possibly find out how far one can go. From his field work, we have learned that market policies, better roads, and telephone connectivity have lifted the standard of living of small Peruvian towns more than that of the medium-sized ones. And that these, in turn, have prospered relatively more than large cities. And here we have Richard's two intellectual drives: lifting people out of poverty and measuring everything, as with the publication Cuánto, which he founded with Graciela Fernández Baca. An original thinker, I recall a speech at the Brookings Institution in 1990, Washington, D.C., in which Richard explained how the progressive state control of the previous quarter century had, paradoxically, collapsed into the forced privatization of almost everything. Whoever wanted electricity had to buy a generator. Whoever security had to hire bodyguards. Whoever education had to pay for a private school, etc., etc. And Richard at that time wondered, and where on earth was the government after so much state control? And he answered, nowhere to be seen. Government was just a screen, and behind the screen there was nothing. Richard held public office twice as president of the Central Bank. Nothing made him change the script of his duty. In his first term, 1980 to 85, abiding by the credit limits of the monetary program made him unpopular with the cabinet, to the point that no government minister attended his father's funeral. In the second term, 2001 to 2003, he refused to go along with the politics of the war and quit. I met Richard in 1987, on my first trip to Peru. We went to dinner to a restaurant in Miraflores with his wife, Pepita. When the meal was served, I commented on Richard's plate, which looked better than what I had ordered. Richard insisted that we swap the plates. No way, I said. But Pepita settled the case by telling me, Richard is not going to touch his plate. He will give it to you. That's the way Richard is. History is non-linear. Small events can trace quite different paths. Meteorologist Edward Lorenz taught us that the flapping of a butterfly in Brazil has the potential to cause a typhoon in Japan. And indeed it can. Here is an example. Once upon a time, a young Englishman from the Cornish Peninsula in Britain worked in Lloyd's of London. One fine day, his boss asked him whether he was interested in a job overseas. And he replied, where to? The boss said, there are two possibilities, Ivory Coast or Peru. Not knowing much about either, the gentleman tossed a coin, heads Peru, tails Ivory Coast. It turned heads. And this is how Philip Webb, Richard's father, came to Peru. And thus, from the toss of a coin, Peru had the privilege of counting on Richard's unparalleled capacity for observation and reflection. Webb, rara avis.